Welcome, welcome everyone. I'm so excited to start this school with you today. This is the first day of the EOF school. As you already have seen in the fantastic video we had before, we are more than 1,000 participants from more than 80 countries around the world. And well, my name is Valentina. And together with Paolo, Maria, Chiara, and Isa, which I sincerely want to thank from the deepest of my heart, we have been tasked to organize this school, which I hope you love in the coming months. So just for you to know, there is the possibility to listen to this school in Portuguese. So you can click on the link below and change your room and have a free translation in Portuguese. And for this, I wish to thank Alvaro, who has volunteered for this task. So first of all, let me warmly greet all of you, both connected here in Zoom and connected through the YouTube channel. So thank you very much for being here. Thank you very much for participating in this school. And I really hope that you will have a good experience with us today and in the following months. So to this aim, let me introduce two instruments that we are going to use during our meetings. So I will share now the screen. And let you see, well, the first instrument. So if you want to take your phone and then scan this QR code, you will be redirected into a Google form where you can add your name and surname. And why this? Well, because this will help us tracking your participation in the school, because you know that if you will participate in at least 75% of the lessons, then you will get a certificate of attendance of the EOF school, and then you will show this certificate of attendance all over the world with a proudness. Fantastic. So don't forget to do this every time. Well, the second instrument is exactly this one, so Mentimeter. So please connect now to menti.com, this website, www.menti.com. Once more, you can do it with your smartphone and insert the code 3213596. So menti.com and use the code 3213596. So don't worry if you hadn't the time to mark this code down, because you will see this code in all the slides I'm going to share with you now. So we will use Mentimeter, so this platform, for two reasons. The first one is that Mentimeter will allow us to ask you some questions. And the second one is that Mentimeter will allow you to put some questions to us. So whenever you need to put some questions, then you will have to go to menti.com and use this code. Don't write any question you will have in the chat, because you will not be able to do this and we are not able to read it now. So please use only menti.com. So ready or not, here we are and we are ready to start. So let me first of all ask you once more to fill in the Google document I shared with you with the QR code. And now let me introduce and leave the floor to Father Augusto Zampini, who's the Deputy Secretary of the Dicastery for Integral Human Development in the Vatican. So Father Augusto, thank you for being here. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Valentina, and thank you also for the invitation to this Economia Francesco School, and to Luigi Nibruni and all your team. It's always an honor to be part of this movement, no? Initiated by Pope Francis, but thanks to your work, it's been furthered, it's been extended. And the first thing I want to say and congratulate you about is that last year you had the Economia Francesco, no? That originally was going to be one event, hopefully to be expanded. The COVID it forced us to expand it before the event, no? So, but this year we are seeing the fruits of all that event and that movement. This is one fruit. So congratulations. What is a fruit about? To think a new economy. And I love the title. I have to say, I love it when I saw that video, no? To rethink the economy, our new economy was starting from the commons, starting from what we have in common. But so this is part of the fruit, to rethink something new in order to enable others to act accordingly. So thank you for that. And the second thing is the importance of the new generation. So Pope Francis could have asked all Nobel Prizes in economics to do this. However, have asked Professor Bruni to organize, you know, to gather together all these young people from all over the world, because the future is in your hands. The future, this is an intergenerational movement, because we need this intergenerational scheme, right, to promote intergenerational justice. In economics, we have a lot of intergenerational injustice, no? Particularly due to the ecological emergency. So we need your view to tackle that injustice. We need also to be Catholic, meaning everywhere. And we are so pleased to have so many people, more than 80 countries, as you said, represented. So thank you very much for that. But also I want to, the last thing would be a quotation from Fratelli Tutti, the last social encyclical of Pope Francis. Pope Francis says that we need the heroes. Well, who are the heroes of tomorrow? The heroes of tomorrow, or the future, will be those who can break with this unhealthy mindset, he says, unhealthy mindset, and determine respectfully to promote truthfulness aside from personal interest. Meaning a healthy mindset is of individualism, no? That's why you want to start from the common, no? Or relativism, you want to seek for the truth, you want to seek for an economy that serves and not that rules. And God willing, Pope Francis says, such heroes are quietly emerging, even now in the midst of our society. In my view, you are these new heroes. So hopefully you can, that this can be like a virus. You can viralize this attitude of transforming the world by rethinking the economy from the commons. Thank you very much. God bless and all the best with your school.
Thank you very much, Father Augusto, for this introduction. We are really, really happy to have you in a sense of board and to have you representing the voice of the Pope. So this is a big deal for us, and we will try to do our best for the future. So now I want you to open menti.com because, well, we said we are from 85 countries all around the world. Well, I really want you to show me where are you from. So go on menti.com and then please fill in. Where are you from? Where are you connecting from? So we are connecting all over the world. Spain, Brazil, Italy, Philippines. Fantastic. Wow. We really have all the world connected with us today. Thank you so much, guys. Germany, Sardinia, France, the Netherlands, Argentina, Burundi, Sri Lanka, England. Wow, 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 wow. Please fill in. And look, more than 156 responses so far. So thank you so much. Colombia, Chile, USA, Mauritius, Switzerland, Mexico. Amazing, amazing. So please keep fill this form. At the end, we will see these word clouds composed and we will try to understand where are we from? Where are you connected? But now, what do you expect from the EOF school? We really want to hear from you. What are you expecting from this school? So we tried our best to organize this school in a way that will accommodate your dreams, at least the dreams of the people participating in the economy of Francesco. But we had some people, let's say, some senior people also joining this school, we really want to learn from you what you expect from the EOF school. So meet and share suggestions on how to leave EOF message, learn about fraternity, and then will be a great experience. Maybe this school give a new soul to all the popular economies in the world. Co-create, learning and new friends. Decolonizao, learning new things, a new perspective on the economy. So thank you so much. Once more, complete filling, continues to fill this this form. At the end, we will have a better idea of what you want to expect from the EOF school. I will leave this on, so please put your answer in the meanwhile. So now, I want to go on in a sense, and to go on, I want to invite Paolo to switch his mic on. So I'm really happy to introduce you and to give the floor to Dr. Paolo Santori. Paolo is a central engine for this school. So Paolo, first of all, thank you so much. And I ask you, all of you, to welcome Paolo with the enthusiasm and the same gratitude I have with him. So please, Paolo, give us some technical details with respect to the school and help us understanding how to deal with this school for the future.
Thank you, Valentina. I confess, I don't know you, but I'm a little bit nervous because the beginning of the Economy of Francesco Scully is a big emotion for all of us. You should see my hand now. But, you know, for all the people who have been working these months to make this happen and possible, it is a great emotion. And also the answer we received in terms of people who joined and scholars who accepted to be our lecturer is amazing, is incredible. But, I mean, I've been asked to tell you something about the structure, the aims, and the contents of the school, and I try to be as short as possible. So let's start from the structure. We will have 12 lessons. Each lesson, leaving aside this introductory meeting, will last roughly 60, 80 minutes with a very linear structure. First, an introduction from a member of the scientific board of the Economy of Francesco, and then the lecture by the keynote speaker we invited, and then three young scholars among the Economy of Francesco participants will discuss the keynote talk, and then a room for Q&A from the audience. Let me stop here to stress two things quickly. On the one hand, the fact that our professors have accepted to be part of the school without reward is valuable. I mean, it tells us, as Professor Bruni, our guest today, in the spite of St. Francis, often say, that this is a mistake to think that what has to do with gratuitousness does not bring any value. Conversely, I have no doubt that you will be direct witnesses that gratuitousness produces value and high quality value. Each of our professors who are outstanding people from academia and beyond will show you what I mean. I really believe that. On the other hand, as you can see, we will still try to let young Economy of Francesco participants to occupy the center stage of the scene together with keynote. Here at the Economy of Francesco, we took very seriously the invitation by the Pope, who asked young economists, entrepreneurs, and change makers to be involved. Why? Because for a change in contemporary economics to happen, we first need a cultural change in the way economics is taught in academia and in the way businesses are run. And we agreed with the Pope that this change is more likely to come from young people, young economists. So I ask you to consider our discussions, ideas, and questions with the very same attention, perhaps more attention that you will do with the keynote talk, because they are as well as important as the main lesson. That said, of course, the school is composed by lessons, but not only. We will organize workshops where the participants of the Economy of Francesco School, you will work together, but you will also have the chance to know each other. I mean, of course, we are doing this school to train, to disseminate knowledge, to produce knowledge about the Economy of Francesco, but also hoping that the school will become in itself a sort of common good, in the sense of a good that can be fully experienced in common. Yes, the relationships will be mediated by the virtual space, but this does not necessarily mean that they will be less valuable. The ties that will be created by and through the school will have their own dignity. And so you might think about them as a kind of kind of on life relational goods. It's like when Valentina was showing the picture and we saw the blank screen, but through your enthusiasm, Valentina, it was like that we were seeing what was on the screen, you know, when you were saying exactly, but this, I mean, things that happened, that it was really the same. And let me say that the school is not a property of few people. We are not stakeholders or shareholders, you are not customer. I would say that here we are all commitment holders or purpose holders. And what is our commitment? Here I quote from the final statement of the Economy of Francesco event in November. We are convinced that a better world cannot be built without a better economy, and that the economy is so important for the lives of people and the poor that we all need to be concerned with it. Translated, we need to put new glasses, new conceptual lenses to observe the economic reality, where the validity of an economic practice and institution is valued starting from the way it treats the disadvantaged, the excluded from the current economic system. This is the common good shared by St. Francis of Assisi, Pope Francis, and us, Economy Francesco people, and the senior that are working with us in the path. So really, we really believe in this. And for this reason, at the end of each lesson, or even at the beginning, we will share handouts and preparatory papers for every lesson. And we'll also collect the ideas that will come out from the workshop, your ideas. We really believe that the knowledge coming from there, first of all, adds value in itself, but also it will be very important for the development of the Economy of Francesco movement. Now you might ask, and I'm going to conclude, okay, great enthusiasm, great expectation, but which are the topics, the contents of the Economy of Francesco School? We followed three lines of thought. First, the first line, the social and economic ideas coming from Franciscan thought. And so we invited historians like Giacomo Todeschini or Franciscan as the Patriarch of Jerusalem, Pier Battista Pizzaballa. Second line of thought, the topics close to the social and economic magisterium of the Pope. So again, Pizzaballa, but the idea of fraternity and sorority in economics with Judy Nelson, the issue of poverty with Sabine Alkair, the issue of care the ethics of care in economics with Jennifer Nadeski. And then we have the third pillar. So how can I say, what we are doing in this school, the third pillar, is that we picked some cross-cutting topics that we think might be interest to all DOF participants and beyond. For example, this year, we will focus on the topic of the commons, considering big data and public health as commons, with outstanding scholars coming from Oxford, UPenn University. But also the first lesson with Professor Bruni today and the last with the economist Robert H. Frank will be theoretical reflection also on the reason why the commons find so little space in economics. And more, we will have scholars lecturing on social business as the French sociologist Yves Capelot. We will have Bob Sagden lecturing on the moral nature of the market, or Alex Edmans on the finance as common good, Christina Bicchieri on common good and social norms. So, I mean, many, many scholars, we are very grateful to have them and to have the chance to learn from them. And I conclude telling you what we ask to you. We ask to you a serious, a steady dedication to following the lessons of the school, which is, I believe, a commitment also to become a sort of EOF ambassadors, Economy Francesco ambassadors, which is the most important thing now and about this school. And Valentina, I think I said enough and with enough emphasis. So now I return the floor to you. Otherwise, I prepared a longer speech, but you know, technical.
Thank you, Paolo. And sorry for the screen. I mean, these technical issues always happen, and today is the first day. So thank you, Paolo. Thank you, Paolo, for your enthusiasm in presenting the school, and also for your competence and the competence you put in organizing this school and the program together with the team. Thank you so much. So, I mean, since I was unable to share the screen before, let me share it now. So this is where you are from. You are from basically all over the world. And thank you for answering and keep answering these questions. And now, if you want, here is also what you expect from the EOF school. Meet and share, and then be a great experience, give understandable and achievable help to change the world to be a better place, and then give a new perspective on the economy, reshape the way I see and learn economics, and so on and so forth. You gave more than 300 answers. We will try to do our best to share this answer with you later on. Now, just to give you an idea, you can use a Mentimeter to add your questions for the speaker. And now it's the time for me to introduce the speaker. So I'm really excited to introduce you, Professor Luigino Bruni. Well, yesterday when I started thinking about how could I introduce him, I started thinking, I had some thoughts about that. So I could have said that he is a full professor at Lumsa University in economics, or I could have said that he is a passionate teacher about the Bible, and he's a scholar studying the Bible and also history of economic thought. But then I could also have said that he is one of the founding fathers of the economy of Francesco. But then I decided to say something different. So I decided to start from something that happened with me. So the first time I met Luigino Bruni. So it was Professor Bruni, you don't remember this episode, but I remember it by heart. So we were both walking in the corridors of one tiny university in Milan, and then it was the first time I met you, but I already know you from your books and your papers in economics. And so you asked me what I was doing during my PhD, and then I briefly told you about my research, and you came up with a sentence that was in a sense engraved in the backwards of my thoughts for these years. So you say, you young people have the prophecy of the already and not yet. And you keep saying this sentence in our meetings in the preparation of the school. And then you add, we should do something together. And then, well, I think Professor Bruni has done so much for us before and during the process of EOF. So thank you, Professor Bruni. And now the floor is yours to open this school.
Grazie, thank you Valentina. I remember very, very well, very clearly in my soul that moment, the encounter. Encounter is better than meeting in this kind of a situation with you. And I'm so happy. Thank you, Padre Augusto. Thank you, Paolo, Maria, Aisa, Lourdes, Chiara, and all the staff that are working with for fostering supporting in a subsidiarity way the economy of Francesco reality in the world. I'm happy to start this my presentation to bring you the greetings from the Pope, because I had the chance to meet him 1 month ago in his house. He was so happy about the continuation of economy of Francesco. He said, andate avanti, go ahead. I'm very enthusiastic about that. Then we are here with the benediction of the Pope, that also Padre Augusto told us. And then this benediction, sorry, I have a little allergy for the spring that is exploded in Italy for an unusual heat that has just arrived to Florence, to Italy. And sorry for that. But the Pope was very, very, very happy. He told me, go ahead. And then I say, okay, I'm not, I try to do my part, but this is a youth movement, all adults here. We are all the sister Alessandra, Luca, everybody working in the economy of Francesco as adults. We are just supporting at service in a subsidiarity way, as I mentioned to you. And then the Pope is with us. And Saint Francis from the sky is also here. The two Francis of our economy of Francesco. Then, okay, I have prepared a small presentation, if I able to share my video, because I'm not so well in so good in the in Eugene, because I'm using another computer. It's not my computer. I hope you can see. Yeah. Okay, this is the title of my presentation, Economics in the Age of Commons. This is a very famous sentence of Thomas Hobbes. It's true that certain living creatures are bees and live socially one with another, and therefore some men may perhaps desire to know why mankind cannot do the same, live sociably one another. And this is a beautiful encounter of Pontormo Visitazione. Okay, first, this idea of the novelties of the so-called Anthropocene. Then we need a return of land, because in classical economics we had three factors: was labor, capital, and land. But in neoclassical revolution, almost one century ago, land disappeared, and together with land disappeared also nature and all the issues related to the environment. And then in this vacuum of land disappeared, and we don't see anymore nature, land, and so on. And then when we don't see something in economics, usually we destroy it. Then I have prepared two, almost three parts of my 20 minutes of presentation. The first is about the fragility of goodness, the relational economics. The second is about specifically the tragedy of commons. The third one is about the economy of Francesco in terms of St. Francis. Very short, is a sort of introduction to some of the issues of the following classes and professors we have here. Then is an introduction, is not a paper. In the next classes, we will have more formal discussions with the contribution of young people. Today is an introduction, is quite a standard one-way presentation. Then the relational issue is very important. We have to rethink economics in a relational way. And then we have to put at the center relationships. This is one issue. And second, we have to put at the center, as Father Augusto mentioned, the commons, the common and public goods. Then to put the commons as the rule and the private goods as an exception. And that is also, that from that comes also a change, a turn in way of teaching economics at school, because usually we start from private good, we consider a public good or commons as exception. Maybe for one class at the end of the year, we have to start putting the commons at the center to consider the private goods as an exception. The fragility of goodness, very, very quickly. You know that from the classical culture, in particular from the Greek and from the Bible, there is the one idea was very central. Our happiness, our well-being depends on others, on reciprocity, but we cannot control the reciprocity of others. And then happiness, good life, is fragile, because vulnerability is an essential dimension of life. We need others, but we cannot control their part, their reciprocity. And then tragedy and good life were very much related to one another, at the two sides of the same coin. We depend on friendship, we depend on love, we depend on reciprocity, but we cannot control that reciprocity, that friendship of the others. Martha Nussbaum, that we also invited for a possible lecture, we hope that she will accept, is very much expert on that. Okay, but not only in the Greek culture, also in the Bible, as Valentina mentioned, also I tried to study a bit of Bible in the last few years. In the Genesis, we have this ambivalence of good life from Cain and Abel up to the fighting between Jacob and the angel, with at the end of this fighting, at the end of this struggle, Jacob was wounded and blessed together. At the same time, he was wounded and blessed. Then the idea that human relations are at the same time wound and blessing. And then if you if you don't accept the encounter with the other for the fear of wound, you don't get the blessing from the others. And then this picture I love very much, this Rembrandt, the fighting between the Jacob and the angels, when Jacob was a winner and wounded and blessed by the angel at the end of the fighting. Then in order to avoid, sorry for running, but it's sort of a concentration of a lot of stuff, but just to give you some ideas, we will develop some of these issues during the school. In order to avoid the wound, communities have invented many mediators, because ego, I and you, alter, this direct relationship is always very dangerous and very, very painful. And then societies invented king, father, priest as a sort of a mediator for avoiding the wound. Then a certain point in modernity, there was a disappearance of the mediator, the son, the highest, the father, the king, the priest, God himself. And then we discover the other, because we, in the fall of the absolute, the fall of the mediator, we turn our head and we discover the presence of the other that is like me. But that discover, as Paolo Santori would say, a lot of stuff, in that discover, the other was a problem. The other is not my happiness, but it is a wolf, is a homo homini lupus. And then the discovery of the other person as a peer was not a good discovery, was a problem. And then we invented other mediators, in particular in politics, the Leviathan, and in economics, the invisible end of the market. But we still wait this moment of the encounter among men and women, because we still continue to mediate in order to avoid the wound of the other. Also in the company, that is the same situation, because in the manager usually plays the same role of the sacral mediator. You don't touch one another with your peer, you pass through the manager. And then in the company, now with that, in the COVID pandemic, the situation is still more severe. Probably the ideal of our organization is to eliminate organization itself and just work each of us at home in order to avoid the wound of the others. And then consumers without shops, banking without bank, online schools without teachers. I wrote this PowerPoint 2 or 3 years ago before COVID. Perhaps even hospital without doctors and nurses, populated by high efficient robots and cameras. Then the elimination of vulnerability will become the elimination of organizations of life in common. And then just to conclude this first part very quickly, immunity, the lack of touch among people for avoiding wound, is the same solution in organization and in economics, in the market. The search of blessing without wound. And then in the age of commons, we need to rediscover the essential link between wound and blessing. And now I go immediately to the second part, because the time runs very, very quickly. As you may know, in 68, Arden published in the review, very important review, Science, The Tragedy of the Commons, that is one of the most influential paper in the second half of the 20th century. The thesis, in the case of commons, that are good we consume together, like park or field in the mountains, or the atmosphere, the climate, the earth itself. In the case of commons, we tend to destroy commons without intending it. Why? Be ready, because in a few minutes Paolo will will come into the stage, giving a turning point to the lecture, to the classes. The example is the common field in the mountains where the farmers can bring their cattle. When you bring one cow more to the field, you have a plus one in terms of benefit. Of course, this cow eat the grass, and there is a reduction of grass in the field, but the cost is divided by the n users of the field. Then the cost is minus one by n, because the cost is divided by all n farmers. Then the private benefit will be always greater than the common cost. And then this is the typical prisoner dilemma situation as a paradigm. Then if we both limit our consume of grass, we get 3 points. Three is a sort of, as you know, stupid number, but just to say three is less than four and more than two. If we limit, we have three. If we don't limit, we are two. We are in a worse situation, because we soon will the grass will end. But if one limit, the other doesn't limit, the other would intend everybody except me, then if I don't stop to bring my cattle to the field and you all stop, I have four, you have one. And then the other way around. That is the typical situation, as you may know, that we explain in the classroom why the Nash equilibrium, the stable equilibrium, the only one in this game is 2-2, where 3-3 will be better off, Pareto superior. 3-3 is not 3,3, like one person in a conference told me after 1 hour that, okay, I was very desperate, but three each. Okay, just try to explain in a better way, and then I leave the floor to Paolo for a few words about history of these ideas. Why, just start from sort of possible explanation in a sort of extended form of the game. Anna can limit or not limit the consumption of grass. If Anna limits, Bruno is up. If Anna doesn't limit, Bruno is down. There is incomplete information. And then if Anna limits, Bruno can limit, of course, and or non limit, because there are two choices also for Bruno. In the case that Anna does limit, Bruno can limit or not. As you know, the payoff of this situation, limit Anna, limit Bruno is 3-3. Limit Anna and non limit Bruno is 4-1. Limit Anna and non limit Anna and limit Bruno is 1-4. Non limit, non limit, 2-2. Then it's easy to show that if Anna limits, Bruno is here, compare the limit and non limit, 3 and 4, he prefer non limit. If Anna doesn't limit, Bruno compare limit and non limit, 1 and 2, he prefer non limit, then in any situation for Bruno is better off. Non limit is consumption. And then the Nash equilibrium of the game is 2-2. We don't limit, we consume all grass and we destroy the commons, the tragedy of commons. But Paolo now will say something about the history of few words about the protagonist of this issue of commons in economics. Please, Paolo, I stop share for a moment.
I'm here, okay. I will share my screen. The PowerPoint, okay. Can you see the PowerPoint? Yes.
Hello.
Yes, louder. I'm here. Yes. So now, as you can see, I titled these windows, the commons and their scholars, because of course it is important to see the women and the men behind the theory, the face behind the ideas. And so let's start with Catherine Coman. You know that Catherine Coman was one of the first historians and economists to study the commons. She was born in Ohio in 1857. And in her case, reconstructing the biography is very important also to see how the intellectual development brought her to consider the issue of the common. In fact, the role of her parents, who the father attended a college important and also the mother was trained in a female important school, was fundamental for her homeschooling education. She was very well educated at home. So when he attended the University of Michigan, she made an enormous impression, both for her characteristic and both for the education she received, to two very important economists, Charles Kendall Adams and Henry Carter Adams, one historian, economist from the German historical school, and another important statistician. Why are we interested in this impression? Because they were so impressed that they invited her to the founding meeting, to the creation of the most important association in economics even today, the American Economic Association, in 1885. And in the American Economic Association had 38/50 people at the first meeting, and Catherine Coman was the only woman. She was 28 years old, by the way. That is, you know, it's impressive. So she became friends of a lot of presidents of the American Economic Association, like Richard T. Ely, another important American economist. She shared with him the passion for John Stuart Mill. But then, of course, there is also some gossip around Catherine Coman, because then she moved from Michigan with just a bachelor to a Wesley College in Boston. She immediately became professor, and then a dean, and then she was offered the dean of the University of Michigan, but refused because she wanted to educate women in that college. She was the first women economy statistician. But if you ask about Catherine Coman, if you would have asked in that period, she was very known for the so-called Boston marriage, because she lived with another woman, another professor of that college. And so you can imagine, you know, the gossip surrounding her and all this stuff, which actually are not very interesting, because what is very interesting here is that she, in 1911, she was the her article was the first article published on the American Economic Review, the journal of the American Economic Association, which is among the top five top journals in economics today. And I capture here the picture, you know, so you can see the American Economic Review, first article, Some Unsettled Problem of Irrigation by Catherine Coman. And this is very interesting also because you see here, I took some quote, but just to focus on the last one, Eleanor Ostrom, who we'll consider in a bit, also with Professor Bruni, after a century of the founding of the American Economic Review, published a paper commenting, you know, Catherine Coman article. Eleanor Ostrom took the Nobel Prize for the study of the commons 2 years before. And look what she wrote, which is very interesting. She said, it is intriguing to read an article published on the first issue, the first article of the first issue of the American Economic Review that describes empirical settings where some participants, but not all, overcame collective actions problems, what Professor Bruni was talking a bit about before. Coman's article illustrates that the typical solution posed to the problem of collective action, turn the problem over to the government, is not a panacea. And this is interesting because if you read the Coman's article, you won't find any quote about the commons or common goods. She mentioned just one, a public good. She was concerned with very specific and practical problem, also due to the influence of Mill. And I'm concluding.
No, just Paolo, one point. You continue with the other hero. The first article on common was written by a woman, and the most important author of commons was another woman, Eleanor Ostrom. That is quite interesting because there is some female dimension in the issue of commons, in the issue of earth, in the issue of water. That is also interesting. There is a gender issue on studying and be interested in in commons as the common house of humanity. Please, Paolo, continue.
Yes. And then we have Garrett Hardin, who was Professor Bruni mentioned, was an American ecologist. He studied zoology, and then he took a PhD in microbiology at Stanford. And then he became, as you can read, a professor of ecology at the University of California. Now, Garrett Hardin was a man with very, I would say, to put it gently, not mainstream positions and ideas. So just to tell you a fact from his personal life, he and his wife committed together voluntary suicide some days after her marriage anniversary. They were both six and both after 80 years old. But they did so because they truly believe that they joined this association named End of Life Choices. They truly believe that human being is the artifacts of his own destiny or her own destiny, even about that included, so that you can choose the time in which you die. So, I mean, this was just one of the peculiarity of Garrett Hardin, but mostly we remember him as a biologist also because, as Professor Bruni was saying, he was a Malthusian or a neo-Malthusian, so very concerned with the problem of the growth of populations in respect of limited resources of the planet. So very famous, for example, is the image of the boat, you know, again, do you know the motto, high tides lift whole boats, meaning that economic growth, especially of the rich, would improve the situation of everyone, of all the people, like high tide. To this, Hardin replicated with another image, very famous. He said, yes, the tide get higher, but the problem is the boat, which is not big enough to carry all the population of the planet. And so if there are few places left on the boat, who will you carry on? And the fact that the tides get higher does not solve this dilemma, actually accelerate the fact that people will die by drowning. Okay.
Thank you, Paolo, for your this beautiful, very, very nice ideas. Then I continue a bit with just in the last part of my PowerPoint. Okay, this is Bruno. Then you, yes. No limit. That is the tragedy. The economic, the individual rationality of economics is not able to save the commons. That is the message of the tragedy of commons. If we don't change rationality, we destroy the commons, even though we don't like it, because we prefer a 3 to 2, but we end into 2. Then it's a tragedy, because we don't want, but we go. Then there are three typical solutions for that. The first is the social contract. But as Conan said, is not the panacea. Because the social contract, the Hobbes solution, but not only Hobbes, because it's a huge solution of collective action, then if you are able to create a sort of sanction, a sort of fine, people that don't limit with -2 in this case, if you find -2 to the ones that don't limit their consumption of grass in the field, then you know the only equilibrium will become 3-3, because it's not any more rational and convenient to no limit than 3-3 will be. But social contract is interesting, but is not always possible for many phenomena. Think about the global climate. Okay, who is able today to convince with a sort of Leviathan, universal police, I don't know, China or US to respect the contract. You need something more intrinsic. And that is the second, then social contract is to pass from here to that. Then the second solution, sorry, I run very, very fast because the time is running more than me. The second option, because also this issue will be also rediscuss in the future classes of our school. The second option is the individual ethics. Let's imagine that the one who limited it himself or herself, the one who respect the limits in consumption or respect in general the environment, gets some intrinsic rewards that we call epsilon, the red one. Then if I get an intrinsic reward, that is ethics, ethics means intrinsic reward, not just extrinsic, like fine or punishment, but intrinsic. If I get an enough huge intrinsic reward, in particular greater than one with these numbers, it's very easy to demonstrate that, then I can choose the limit option even though I will be the only one. That became the strictly dominant strategy. Because for me it's better, even one plus one epsilon is better than two. Because the only one respecting the environment is better than being the both not respecting, because the intrinsic reward changes my preferences, of course, and then changes my choices. That is the so-called ethical individual ethics. But there is also the third solution among us. There are people like Alessandra Smerilli working on that. Also one of our special guests, Professor Robert Sagnen, in the next classes will is another scholar of the we rationality or collective intention or we thinking school. Alessandra is one of the major experts on that. Then the solution of we rationality to pass from I to we. In this case, the very, very simple way, as you know, is very formal, very mathematics, but just to give you an idea. If you start from thinking on we, what count for you is not anymore your individual payoff, 3, 4, 1, 2, but is the sum of payoff that becomes. Is a sort of you interiorize the social welfare in your individual function. Then 3 plus 3, of course, is better than 2 plus 2, 4, 6 and 4. But what is interesting, even 1 plus 4 is greater than 2 plus 2. Then it's better to be the only one than 0. Even though I'm the only one respecting the environment, 1 is better than 0, even though I'm the only one. That is the we rationality solution. It is very interesting. We will discuss that in the future. Then the last question on this before going to the conclusion to St. Francis. How many we player, or how many players with the epsilon we need for changing society? There are papers on that called as a strong reciprocity. That is a very promising, interesting field of research. If condition, the game is repeated, not one shot, but repeated, we meet many times. Second, if the we agent are enough sophisticated, they punish, for instance, with some cost, the so-called strong reciprocity or strategic altruism, then a small share of we agent or intrinsic motivated agent can invade the whole population. That is a very simple representation. We start 5% of prophetic minority and 90% of non-cooperators. It's not impossible that at the end of the time, then the prophetic minority can become the new culture of the population. Then to conclude with a very few mention to the economy of Francesco. As you may know, or at least as some of you know, the Francesca movement played an important role in the birth of market economy. That is one of the most generative paradox of Western civilization, a movement based on altissima povertà, the highest poverty, that created also a new economic culture, banks and economic theory. And then, but the role of Francesca is much more important than in general we think. Why? This only the gospel, no, this only is, was this this adverb was essential, the only gospel. And then the poverty was so essential for Francesca that they even cannot touch money, even with a stick. They have no contact with money at all. They cannot bring money in the pocket. Totally, they have to ask some other people to carry with them for bringing money, because the Francesca cannot touch coins. But from that altissima povertà, highest poverty, they invented something new. And then they proposed something that was absolutely fantastic, the distinction between use of things and property or possession. The idea, use without possession. They, for one century, the best theologians, philosophers, Francesca, Duns Scoto, Bonaventura, Pietro Olivi, the giants of the Middle Age philosophy, they try to convince the church that it's possible to use something without being the owner. Uso senza possesso, use without possession. And then the idea was just an horse as an actual use for, but not the ownership of the host at it. So religion man, the Frey, as a simple factual use of bread, wine, and clothes, without being owners. Then they try to be associated juridically to minors, to incapable, or to madmen, in order to not possess anything. Think about the huge revolution of that. And Dante, with this beautiful verse of Divina Commedia, Paradise, in Italian first, o ignota ricchezza, o ben ferace, scalzasi Egidio, scalzasi Silvestro, dietro lo sposo, sì, la sposa piace, no? O wealth unknown, o fertile goodness, Egidio bears his feet, Sylvester is beyond the groom, so pleasing is the bride. Only Dante could enclose Francis' idea of paradise in one single verse. And then was a totally unsuccess, this idea of Francesca, because after one century, the Franciscans was the Pope, Giovanni XXII, John XXII said, no, it's impossible to use without property. You must be the owner of convent, of food, of clothes, and so on. And then this utopia, concrete utopia of Francesca, did become the economic culture of capitalism. It was based, of course, as you know, on private property and so on. But according to me, is also thanks to Francis' fidelity to his charism, if 8 centuries later, you, economists, were able to say in Assisi in November, all goods are common goods, economy Francesco. Then to conclude, going back to the prophecy of Gioacchino da Fiore, the first Franciscan believed that, because as you know, I don't know if Paolo can show this picture of Gioacchino da Fiore. Gioacchino da Fiore was the author of the prophecy of the three times of the church. The first time was the Old Testament, the time of the Father. The second time was the New Testament, the first millennium. It was the time of the Son. And the third time, or the last time, was the time of the Spirit, of the Holy Spirit. And then the Franciscan said, the prophet of the third time, the prophet of the era of the Spirit will be Francesco. And then with the third millennium, we have now entered into the era of the commons. If we continue to think and to use the commons as a possession, we destroy the planet. We have to reinvent a way of using commons without possession, respecting, not consuming, not destroying in a non-possessive way. And then we must learn the an economy of Francesco. Then that prophecy that didn't become the economic culture of the Middle Age, that didn't become the economic culture of modernity, can, I would say, must become the economic culture of the 30 millennium if we will survive. And then the economy of sine proprio, without no property, will be that of the era of common goods, will be the economy of Francesco that will save both us and the earth at the end. If Paolo can, if you can show the beautiful picture of Gioacchino da Fiore, then we conclude. Paolo?
Yes, I'm here. I have to be allowed to speak. No, I have to
be sleeping?
A bit, not joking. No, Professor, I need you to stop your screen sharing.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, and now I will do my...
I hope you enjoy it a bit. I don't know, but...
Can you see it?
That is his theory of church, Mysteria Ecclesia, organized in seven times, because in the first part of his theory, he distinguished in three times. At the end, in seven times, following the revelation, the Apocalypse, and that is a manuscript of Gioacchino da Fiore, was an Italian Cosentino, Calabria monk of the 11th century, and that is his beautiful theory of a church. Thank you for listening. Thank you for your question, that probably are too many, because Maria told me that are about 87 questions. I think it's quite difficult to try to answer in a few minutes. Valentina, what we can do now with the deal with questions?
Okay, thank you so much. So indeed, we had around 100 questions, so it's really too much, but I propose you to do something. So we will, so I'm proposing this without sharing this idea with the other organizers. So I hope this work, but we can share those questions with you guys in your using your email address. And then we ask you to vote. And we will pose two questions to Professor Bruni, the most selected one and the least selected one. And we ask you, Professor Bruni, to answer those questions in the coming meetings.
Yes, my email, I don't promise you to reply to your question, but my email, I can write here. No, yeah. You find my email everywhere, but it's l.bruni@lumsa.it is my university, or luigino.bruni@gmail.com. I will try to, because there are so beautiful questions, and then not just to me, but we can try to answer together with Paolo, Valentina, they know more than I.
What we will do, Professor, is that we will...
Professor is probably it's better to call me Luigino, it's easier. Yeah. Because you call me Luigino every day, and now that professor doesn't work very well.
Okay, so Luigino, what we will do in the coming EOF gatherings and EOF workshop is that we will work together with you, participants to this school, on the topics we have introduced during the lessons, So don't worry if we don't answer your questions now, because they are more than 100, 110. So we will do it in the coming meetings and in the coming workshops. Just
also, Valentina, maybe to remind that Paolo is preparing some material, no? Some,
yeah, exactly.
Some papers for the participants.
Exactly. We are sharing with you every time we have a lesson, a small set of papers, not for these introductory lessons, that was just exactly an introduction to the topics of the economy of Francesco, but for the next lessons, we will share with you before the lesson some papers to be read, and then we will also share with you and write with you guys some material that will, in a sense, constitute the bonding, the bonds of the Economy of Francesco School, and that will help us in continuously thinking about the topic used in the lessons.
It's nice that in my head there is this sort of ring that is like the aureola of the Economy of Francesco. I don't know if you can see that.
Yeah, so I now wish to thank you, Lugino, for this amazing lesson. And then, Paolo, I leave the floor to you for a brief conclusion and a discussion about the further steps.
Okay, so this time I'm able to speak immediately, that's fine. And so, okay, we are at the conclusion. Actually, probably I will ask also Professor Bruni, I'm still talking to him as Professor Bruni, to share just two or three papers with the participant. Could be an idea, even ex post, it could have some value.
Maybe also my slides, if they...
Exactly. So I was thinking in a PDF way. So of course I conclude thanking you, Professor, and for the lesson, because I think it really set the time and the space in which the school will move. And so now it remains to say two things, and then we will say goodbye. First of all, we will see you next lesson with the Patriarch of Jerusalem, Pier Battista Pizzaballa. He will give a lecture very important on peace, fides, meaning both faith and trust, and economy. And as always, we will send you the link. The hours will remain the same, and we will try to be on time. And so 4 p.m. Italian time or CIT time. Of course, if you have any question or queries or whatever, you can write to Valentina. No, I'm joking. No, you can write to uefschool2021@francescoeconomy.org. I repeat it, uefschool2021@francescoeconomy.org. And now it remains to say goodbye. I would like actually to show all the people who are really working on this, like Lourdes, Maria. I will ask them to open their microphone and video, but I know that they're a little bit shy, but you know that the people that you see on the flyer and the manifesto, me, Valentino, we did probably the most important work, the Maria, Chiara, Lourdes, but they are shy, so they will leave us alone here. And Professor, if you want to say last word to conclude.
No, just what you said at the beginning. I'm very happy for today to have the chance also to share with all over the world, with people so far away, to share ideas. Also, not just ideas, but also this heritage of Francis, this heritage of our culture. And then if you, in Africa, in South America, in Europe, in Asia, in North America, you want to spread also to your friends, your colleagues, this possibility to follow the following classes, because as you know, there is also YouTube. It's possible to invite, to be missionaries of this new way of understanding the economy, because we can invite other people, maybe at least just to listen, or without maybe the certificate, but spread the idea of Francesco in your cities, in your university, in your companies, and not only to academics, but also to businessmen, businesswomen, to everybody. Thank you for your trust, thank you for your fidelity, because now we are about 2 years of the beginning of this process. It's a lot of time for young people. And then thank you for being here, for being faithful to your place, to your, like the prophet Isaiah, I'm like the sentinel in Italian, the shomer in my place, I'm there, I'm always there with the perseverance, with the strength. Thank you very much to Valentina e Paolo, to all the staff. We are here for you. Please ask, also give us a suggestion for improving, because everything is for you. We are very, very happy, so happy to work together for each of you. Goodbye.
Bye.
And also for Lionello, thank you for the